Hi, my name is Bill Kinney, and this is the first of what I hope will be many videos on problem solving related to helping people study for Actuarial Exam 2, also called Actuarial Exam FM, FM standing for Financial Math. In this first video, we're going to take a look at problem 1.1.4s in Broverman, the 6th edition. Here's what the book looks like. And the S stands for the fact that this is a problem that was on an old actuarial exam. It's about using an equation of value to solve for an unknown withdrawal. And here is the problem statement. Carl puts 10,000, you know, it could be dollars, could be euros, it doesn't matter. It's an amount of money into a bank account that pays an effective annual interest rate of 4%. Okay, let's stop there for a second. That 4% in actuarial notation is typically labeled with the letter I. I standing for interest rate, it's not the same as the imaginary unit by any means. 4% means 4 hundredths or 0.04, and when you plug it into your calculator, that's how you'll typically plug it in. An important quantity related to this is the quantity 1 plus I, which would be 1.04. You could call this the growth factor. In fact, to be more specific, it would be the annual growth factor for this problem. Interest is credited at the end of each year, once per year. It's going to be in there for 10 years. All right, there's some withdrawals that are made. And if a withdrawal is made during the first 5.5 years, there's a penalty of 5%. So this might be like a certificate of deposit where you get a penalty if you withdraw too soon. Carl withdraws K. K is the unknown amount we want to solve for at the end of years 4, 5, 6, and 7. The balance at the end of year 10 is 10,000. The goal here is to calculate K. That is our goal. All right. It's almost always in these kinds of problems helpful to draw a number line. Starting at time 0 and ending at time whatever. Here in this case it's 10 years, so this is going to be a 10 over here. So I'm going to label my times below the number line. And I'm going to label my deposits and withdrawals on top of the number line. I've got the 10,000 deposit. I'll put a plus sign with that at time 0. And I've got with these 4 withdrawals at times 4, 5, 6, and 7, right about here, 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 and here. Withdrawals made during the first 5.5 years have a penalty. So the withdrawals that I make in years 4 and 5 are going to have a penalty. So the amount that I take out because of the penalty, say for the first withdrawal, is not k, but 1.05 times k. Let me put a minus there to emphasize that that is a withdrawal. You don't have to do that, I just think it's helpful. There's also a withdrawal at year 5 that has the 5% penalty. So the total withdrawal is 1.05. Of course, I'm just getting k of that, not the 1.05k of that. 5% is going to the bank. At the end of year 6 and 7, there's no penalty, so I just withdraw k at the end of those years. My final amount at the end of year 10 is 10,000. That's just my final amount. Let me put this up higher. So what's the principle here? The principle is with this interest rate, with time value of money being taken into account, if I push all these amounts forward to year 10, 10 years after the present, and combine them in an arithmetic way with a plus sign for the deposits and a minus sign for the withdrawals, that should end up equaling 10,000 at the end, and that will give me an equation of value that I can solve for k. You don't have to do this, but it might be helpful to imagine pushing all 5 of these amounts forward in time to time 10 and combining them again, and they have to equal 10,000. You might wonder, is this a valid way to solve the problem? The answer is, it is. If we have time here, maybe at the end I'll talk about sort of an abstract justification for this problem-solving method, but we'll see how we are here on time as we go. All right, so let's write down these amounts here. What we're writing down here is the future value or the accumulated value of these different amounts at time 10. So you've got the $10,000 deposit. It needs to be pushed forward in time 10 years. It needs to be multiplied by 1.04 10 times, so I need to raise 1.04 to the 10th power. What is that? Let's go ahead and use the BA2 plus calculator here. All right, let's see, got to turn it on. So we've got 1.04 to the 10th power. So I typed in a 1.04. Here's the power key right there, y to the x. 10th power equals that. Multiply that by 10,000. There's what we get. Let me go ahead and write that down. 14,802 and 44 cents, say, if it was dollars. But let me go ahead and carry more decimal places. I always get a little paranoid about decimal places and errors piling up on me. I'll go ahead and keep more decimal places. And let me go ahead and store that value in the calculator's memory here. If I press STO and then 0, I have stored that value in the memory register labeled with a 0. All right. Now let's look at the other values. You've got the withdrawals, including the penalties. So we've got negative 1.05k at time 4 being taken out of the account. Find the future value of that. Push that in forward in time. Accumulate that forward 6 years. I need to multiply that by 1.04 to the 6th. All right, so let's go ahead and do that now. So I have 1.04 to the 6th power. There it is. Times 1.05, don't forget about the penalty. That's going to be multiplied by k. I will write that down, but let me also store it in memory register 1. So I press STO and hit 1, and that should now be stored there. Let me go ahead and write it down as well. 1.32858 4969 times k. Hopefully I don't make a mistake here. Double check my work. All right, that looks good. Same kind of thing for the other ones. 1.05k times 1.04 to the 5th power for this withdrawal at time 5 and the penalty. Push that forward 5 years to time 10. There would also be a negative k times 1.04 to the 4th for this one. At time 6, it has no penalty. And a negative k times 1.04 to the 3rd for the one at time 7. All right, let's go ahead and find these things out now. Let's see, 1.04 to the 5th power times 1.05. I'm going to store that in register 2, STO2. All right, I will also write it down. With a minus sign here, minus 1.27748558k. 1.04 to the 4th power. There's no penalty for that one. I can just write that down and store it. Let's see, 5856. Okay. I will store that in register 3. All right, one more to go here. 1.04 to the 3rd power, negative 1.124864. I don't need to bother storing that one because now I can just add on what's stored in the other registers, except for the one that was in register 0, which is this one. Let's see, so I want to add on register 1, so I press RCL1, add on what was in register 2, RCL2, add on what was in register 3, RCL3. All right, there we go. What we have here then, if we combine all these, is 14,802.44285 minus 4.900793077k. That must equal the final value at time 10, which was 10,000. Up here, coming from this. There is your equation of value that we can algebraically solve for k now. I would need to bring the 4.900793077k to the other side, say, by adding it to both sides, and then also subtract 10,000. And I would get 4,802.44285 equals 4.90079307K. And then I divide both sides. Sorry about that there. Divide both sides by the 4.9. I can just take the reciprocal of it on the calculator here or store it. I'll press the reciprocal button there, 1 over x. Take 1 over that and multiply it times 4802.44285. It looks like k is 979.93. And that is the answer. I double-checked it and in an answer key that I have. That is the value of k. I think we do have a few minutes to talk about why this method here of taking not only the deposits, but also with the withdrawals and finding all their future values, combining them, pluses for deposits, minus for withdrawals, and setting them equal to that final amount. Why is that a valid method? And I think what we're after here is let's just imagine a general situation. Say like this here, you've got time zero when you make some deposit, let's call it deposit A, and time one, actually let's call this T1 plus T2 over here. This amount of time is going to be T2. So A is a deposit that's made at time zero, and W is a withdrawal that's made at time T1. If we were going to think about how much money is in the account at time 0, at time t1, and at time t1 plus t2, the traditional way to think about it would be like this, to say, okay, we've got to take the amount A, multiply it times 1 plus I to the t1 power. So again, I is the interest rate, 1 plus I would be the growth factor. This is t1 years, say. That would be the value at time t1 just before that withdrawal of W. Go ahead now and take out W, and then take that amount and push it forward in time by T2 years. You need to multiply this by 1 plus I to the T2 power. But now I can use the distributive property to take this expression and distribute it through the parentheses. So I'm justifying what I do here by algebra. What would I get? I'd get A times 1 plus I to the what power? You'd have to add those exponents, t1 plus t2 power, and then you've got minus w times 1 plus I to the t2 power. So what this is showing you is there's really two ways of finding the final value of this cash flow at time t1 plus t2. You could find the value again at time t1. It would be this right before the withdrawal. It would be this. Take away the withdrawal. This would be the value right after that withdrawal, and then you'd take that amount and push it forward in time by T2 years, according to this interest rate. Or you could take both the deposit and the withdrawal individually, the withdrawal with a minus sign, and push them forward in time the appropriate amount, A by T1 plus T2 and negative W by T2. The algebra here verifies that this method of problem solving, which essentially reflects this expression that I did up here, is valid. And that will be the end of this first video.